What I'm trying to get at is this, is that the Bible is more important than Matt being a nurse practitioner knowing the islet of Langerhans and beta cells. It's more important than Robert knowing how many barrel tanks they got on the yard. And it's more important than knowing how to work a lathe, because we're talking about the eternal soul. And so I'm just going to be perfectly honest with you. Once again, I'm going to remind you that the word disciple means a learner of Christ. And so, you know, and I don't mean to, look, man, I don't have a bad attitude. I promise I don't. But I'm tired of people like, oh, man, he teaches the Bible and I can't understand it. Well, hold on a second. Time out. It's because I'm not teaching the Bible. And it's because sometimes the Bible's like a foreign language because we haven't applied ourselves to it. Amen? And when you start digging into Daniel chapter 9, it's just not going to come that easy. Amen? So listen, we're going to take our time. We're going to go slow. We're going to study the scriptures. We're going to ask the Lord to give us revelation. Amen? We're not going to go too fast. As a matter of fact, I'm about to start preaching and I'm going to time myself. Amen? Don't let me go past 8:20. No, don't let me go past 8:15. Stop me. Make me stop. All right? No matter where I am, make me stop. Alright, we got to. It's madness. I can't try to teach you all this in one shot. Alright, and we need to repeat ourselves. Alright, let's go ahead and read Daniel chapter 9, at least portions of it. We will start off, I'm going to kind of just skip around a little bit. Let's start in verse 1 of Daniel chapter 9. In the first year of Darius, the son of Azarias, of the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans. Now, what does all that mean? We already got to stop. Now, if you've been coming on Sunday mornings, we've been talking about this. And this is important, so I'm going to go ahead and stop for a second. Listen, the nation of Israel is God's people, amen? And God created his own nation. There was a time in the ancient past when there was no nation belonging to God. After the Tower of Babel and mankind was in rebellion against God, and they began to build a tower, and what they say, we will ascend into the heavens. And I thought what that meant was that they were trying to build a skyscraper, and God thought that they were going to come knock on his door, and so he confused their languages whenever I started to study the history of the occult, and I realized, no, they were worshiping demonic spirits and fallen angels on these structures of these pyramids and these ziggurats that were making contact with spiritual beings. I don't know how you feel about that. You came to the wrong church if you don't believe in the spiritual realm. I believe in the spiritual realm. Because I'm here to tell you that the thing that plagues people and keeps them bound by drugs and keeps them bound by alcohol and keeps them bound by lust and keeps them bound by everything else that'll bind them is a spiritual thing. And there's only one way to have freedom over a spiritual thing, and it's through a spiritual victory. Amen. And the spiritual victory came through Jesus. Amen? Amen. The sinless one. Yes. The righteous one. Who died on the cross and paid the penalty. And when you put your faith in that, oh, I told somebody that today. Listen, I was a Christian for 12 years and didn't even know what the word justified meant. Come on, somebody. That's a poor excuse for a Pentecostal preacher or a charismatic preacher that's going to talk all about how much the Holy Spirit's going to help you in your life. And the people go to church all those years and they don't even know what it means to be justified, to be declared righteous in the eyes of God because of the sacrifice of Jesus and your faith in that, allowing you to be clothed with his righteousness. All right, Tower of Babel. And they're over there and they're engaging in occult worship. And God confuses their languages. He spreads people all over the world so that they would repopulate the world. But then he finds a man named Abraham out of the place that we now call Babylon. And he called that man out and he created a nation out of him. You remember that story? He said Abraham had Isaac, Jacob. Jacob, the 12 sons, which were the 12 tribes of Israel. They became the nation of Israel in Egypt. Amen? On the Passover night, he delivered them out. They became, and they entered into the promised land. They became the nation. Through the nation, we were given Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. But listen, during the time frame of Israel's history, they became disobedient. I'm talking about the Medes. Darius was a king. Daniel's saying that he's about to start praying. And it's during the time frame that Darius is the king. He's a king of Persia, or it was the Medo-Persian Empire. The Medes and the Persians were together at first, And then after a period of time, the Persians became more powerful and conquered them. The Persia is modern-day Iran. All this stuff's important because all this stuff has to do with end-time prophecy. Some people don't like it when I do this, but I'm about to do it. Rick Warren tells people not to study end-time prophecy. He tells people not to study end-time prophecy because we don't need to worry about that. Let Jesus come back when he wants to come back. Hold on a second. What'd you say? The Word of God says that there's a blessing for the man that'll study the book of Revelation. There's a blessing for the people of God that they might inquire to see what God is doing upon this earth. And let me tell you something, there's a whole lot of crazy things happening on this earth that we don't even know about. There's an enemy of our soul, and he has a plan too, and he's a master deceiver. Let me tell you something. He clothes himself in religion. He presents himself as an angel of light. I didn't say that. The Apostle Paul did. He transforms himself into an angel of light, and he makes himself look one way when in reality, he's altogether something different. We better be sober. The Word of God says, be sober. Amen. Your adversary, the devil, roams around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Help us, Lord, to be sober-minded. See, when you're not sober, you're in a drunken stupor. You can't see where you're going. You're stumbling. You're fumbling. Come on, I've been there. I can talk about it. I'm allowed to talk about that, by the way, if I want to, because I've been there enough times. I can't tell you how many times I woke up in the morning and didn't even know what in the world I did the night before. I'm not proud of that. That's where most of humanity is. The Word of God says in Revelation 17 and 18 that the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication, talking about false religion. All right, I got to stay focused. The point that I'm trying to make is that God created a nation for himself named Israel, and in their captivity, there was a succession of kingdoms. Because they didn't listen to the prophets, Babylon brought them under captivity. After that, the Medo-Persian Empire brought them under captivity. After that, Alexander the Great was now the one who was ruling, and at the time of Jesus, it was the nation of Rome. All of that bears in effect to some of the things we're going to be talking about in this Daniel 9 chapter. I can assure you that we won't finish it tonight. It might be 2 or 3 weeks. But so, this is the time frame. Daniel, you remember the story of Daniel? Daniel was before this captivity. As a matter of fact, Daniel was over here somewhere, and he was a young teenage boy, and he was just minding his own business, and I'm not embellishing the story. I'm just trying to tell you the story the best way that I can understand it and trying to fill in the blanks. He's over there doing what teenage Jewish boys do one day. And all of a sudden, Nebuchadnezzar's army shows up. Probably about your age. Y'all's Tuesday, maybe a little bit older than y'all. And they're just sitting there minding their own business, doing things that young boys did at the time. And all of a sudden, the army marches up, and they take people captive. And what they did was, is they took the best young boys that had the most intelligence, that came from royal families, and they chained them up and they began to haul them, and it'd be as though you walked from Houma to San Antonio, Texas, and you were now a prisoner of a completely different foreign country, spoke a completely different language, and that was Daniel's life. One day he's fine living in the midst of his own home, and the next thing you know, he's sitting behind bars or he's in some kind of a prison, imprisoned situation, and he's being enticed by the ways of the world to go the ways of the world, and instead he chooses, no, we're not going to bow now, and hallelujah, he didn't. He made it through the lion's den. But what I want you to know is that now he's an old man. He's been sitting there in Babylon. And not only that, now there's been a power shift. I've been preaching this on Sunday mornings. By the way, I just want y'all to know, when we get to the Nehemiah part of Daniel, I got to tell you something. I'm not that smart. I'm just not. I'm not that smart to plan to preach Nehemiah to realize the effect it was going to have on Daniel when we got here. I'm just telling you. The Holy Spirit's in it. And on Sunday mornings, we've been learning about Nehemiah, and it's integral to what is going on right here. I just thank the Lord that he knows how to take care of foolish people like me, and he leads us in the right direction. So if you've been here on Sunday mornings and you've been learning about Nehemiah, it's very important that we understand those things regarding this Daniel passage. Amen? So now Daniel is older. He's been seeking the face of God. And now he's seeking God to get a revelation of when this transgression is going to stop. What do you mean by transgression? Well, we're going to read through some of this. But basically what's happened is that Jerusalem has been ransacked. It's been destroyed. The walls are broken down. The temple is broken down. Amen. There's no worship there. Everybody's been brought as captives to another foreign country. And the people that they left over there in Jerusalem, they don't even really know how to worship the Lord anyway. And so Daniel is seeking the face of God, and he says in chapter, verse 2, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by books the number of the years whereof the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolations of Jerusalem. Now, what does that mean? It means that the prophet Jeremiah, I wasn't really going to turn here, but I think I am, because we're just going to kind of take our time. And we're going to see where the Lord leads us. 2 Corinthians chapter 36. Not Corinthians, I'm sorry. 2 Chronicles. I keep saying that. 2 Chronicles, Old Testament. What does the book of Chronicles teach or tell us? Basically, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings tell us about the prophets and the kings during the time frame when Israel was disobedient. And the Chronicles, 1 and 2 Chronicles, chronicle all those kings, all those prophets, and some of the various history that takes place. But Jeremiah says something right here in verse 20. He says, and them that had escaped from the sword carried you away to Babylon, where they were, or this is chronicled about Jeremiah, where they were servants to him and his sons until the reign of the kingdom of Persia, to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah until the land had enjoyed her Sabbaths. For as long as she lay desolate, she kept Sabbath to fulfill 70 years. Boy, that's a lot of information, huh? You see how so... That's 2 Chronicles chapter 36. Okay, that's cool. 36 verses 20 through 21. So basically, what's happening, and I got to tell you some of this because I can't just keep flipping back and forth. It's going to take too much time. Basically, what's happened here is that God said in the book of Leviticus that the children of Israel were supposed to keep a Sabbath. You remember that? We taught on the feast days a while back. Mm-hmm. They were supposed to keep a Sabbath. They were supposed to rest. And there was supposed to be a rest for the land. Every seventh year was supposed to be a rest for the land. They weren't supposed to till the ground. Okay? They weren't supposed to till the ground. They weren't supposed to sow seed, from what I remember. I'm kind of shooting from the hip. And instead, God was going to provide for them, and they were going to be able to eat off of what they had before and what the land grew wild. And they were going to let the land rest. And in my opinion, it all has to do with the fact that Jesus ultimately is our rest. He's the fulfillment of rest. It's not about how many times you go to church on a Sunday. Don't get me wrong, I want you at church on Sunday because that's kind of boring preaching to an empty crowd. But not only that, we're supposed to come together as community and grow in Christ together, amen, and to serve the Lord together. But Jesus is truly our rest, amen. And we're supposed to trust that he's got the provision. Not just what we're going to eat, amen, but that he provided us a lamb to give us the victory that we need in order to live for him. Nevertheless, Israel, what they did was they connected themselves to the world. The Israeli men married women from other countries. Their kings did the same thing. And the very thing that God warned them was going to happen, happened. They began to worship false gods. And I've told you all about that multiple times. They began to worship false gods. They began to go the wrong way. There's a message in there for you as a single Christian today. Don't connect yourself to the people of the world. I'm talking about you. I'm not even just talking about getting married to somebody. Oh, Lord, please help you. If you yoke yourself to an unbeliever, Lord Jesus, help you. What kind of craziness is that? You're not. I'm telling you, you got to question whether or not you really even got enough sense in your head to call yourself a Christian if you're going to connect yourself to an unbeliever. I know that sounds harsh, but I'm telling you, you're not going to be able to serve Jesus if you yoke yourself up with a person that's not living for him. They're going to drive you to go in another direction. I'm telling you the truth. I'm not lying to you. I'm not going to water it down. The Lord told me to tell the truth. Amen. And not only just in a romantic type relationship, I'm talking about friendships. If you spend too much time with the world and connect yourself, I'm not saying that you got to isolate yourself. Amen? I'm not telling you to go lock yourself up in a padded room because you're scared sin's going to jump on you and you can't go to Walmart without earplugs because you're scared that you won't hear some song that's going to make you go run off and get drunk. Come on. Come on, somebody. I mean, I know. I'm being serious, though. Some people are so freaked out about stuff. I mean, I'm not telling you to go connect yourself to it. You get the point I'm trying to make. We got to be careful that we don't connect ourselves to the world. But that's what Israel did. That's what Solomon did. He connected himself to women of the world. They drove him to worship false gods. And he built altars for false gods. It was bad. Yeah. And the nation of Israel, the kingdom was split. and they began to worship. It was bad, okay? But in the midst of it all, what they also did was they refused to leave the ground until what God had told them to do. And that's His property. And you know why it's His property? It's His property because it belongs to His Son. Because one day His Son, amen, is going to come back and He's going to rule and reign from that piece of property that God gave to Israel. And they weren't being good stewards of the property that God had given them. And so what happened is that you see what it says right there in that 2 Chronicles passage. I already turned away from it, but I wanted to point that out real quick. 2 Chronicles 36, verse 21. To fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah until the land had enjoyed her Sabbaths. For as long as she lay desolate, she kept Sabbath. To fulfill 70 years, 70 years. One score is 20. 3 times 20 is 60. Plus 10 is 70. 70 years. For as long as she lay desolate. Who's she? Well, as long as you got the people that live there bound up in another country, they can't plow the land anymore. You know, that's kind of like the thing that happens sometimes in people's lives. God's speaking to them. The people won't listen. So the next thing you know, he puts them in another situation where they have to obey in the situation that he's asking them to obey. And basically, that's what God did to Israel. He picked them up. He plucked them up. He made them go live in another land. He said, my land will not be tilled. And so he left them there for 70 years so that a fulfillment of time of all those years of Sabbaths, amen, could be completed. All right. Now the end of those 70 years is getting near the end. And Daniel, he's been in captivity. He was that young boy I told you about. Now it's in the time frame of the empire of the Persians or the Medes. And now Daniel goes to the Lord and he begins to pray. And it says right there in the second part of verse 2, came to Jeremiah the prophet that would accomplish 70 years in the desolations of Jerusalem. Daniel goes on to say, I set my faith, verse 3, I set my face unto the Lord God to seek by prayer and supplications with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. You know, there's some discomfort in true repentance. You know, they put sackcloth on their body. Take their clothes off and they put sackcloth on their body. It was very uncomfortable. I'm just saying that true repentance isn't just I'm sorry. True repentance fills the heart of God and says, Lord, I want to go your way. And it's uncomfortable. Amen?
Amen.
Lord, help us.
Yeah.
He goes on to say in verse 4, and I prayed unto the Lord my God and made my confession and said, O Lord, the great and dreadful God, keeping the covenant and mercy to them that love him and to them that keep his commandments, we have sinned and have committed iniquity and have done wickedly and have rebelled even by departing from your precepts and from your judgments. In other words, we haven't followed your word, Lord. Neither have we hearkened unto your servants, the prophets, which spoke in your name repeatedly. God sent prophets to warn Israel during those time frames of the kings to turn away to the name to our kings and our princes and our fathers and to all the people of the land. O Lord, righteousness belongs unto you, but unto us confusion of faces. As at this day to the men of Judah and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and unto all Israel that are near and that are far off through all the countries, whether thou hast driven them because of their trespass, that they have trespassed against thee. So I'm going to go ahead and fast forward a little bit, and let's go to verse 19. You see what he's doing. He's praying. He's seeking God for the things that have happened in the past. He goes on to say, O Lord, our Lord, forgive. O Lord, hearken. In other words, lend us your ear. And defer not for thy own sake. In other words, Daniel's saying, I know we're a mess, Lord. I know we haven't done what you desired for us to do, but for your own sake, won't you show up and do something to help us in the midst of our calamity? Won't you show up and do something, amen, to set us free from this situation of captivity? Verse 20, and while I was speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of my people, Israel, and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God. What does that mean? Jerusalem, the holy mountain. There's a Mount Zion in the city itself. Well, yes, while I was speaking in prayer, even the man Gabriel, talking about angel Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly touched me about the time of the evening oblation. What does that mean? There were two sacrifices every day, one at 9 o'clock in the morning, one at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Gabriel shows up while Daniel's praying, and all of a sudden he flies swiftly and he touches Daniel about 3 o'clock in the afternoon about the time of the evening sacrifice. And he informed me and talked with me. And by the way, it's important that you understand that if you'll read this whole Bible in its right context, you're going to see sacrifice after sacrifice after sacrifice, blood after blood after blood, and it's all pointing to the cross. Amen. It's all pointing to the sacrifice of Jesus, because there is no relationship with God without the remission of sins, and there is no remission of sins without the shedding of blood. Amen.
Amen.
It goes on to say, at the beginning of your supplication, or Gabriel saying, at the beginning that you started to pray, the commandment came forth, and I am come to show you, for you are greatly beloved. Well, wouldn't you like to be called that by God? Amen?
Yes.
Daniel had a good name in God's eyes. You are greatly beloved. Man, that's a good testimony. Therefore, understand the matter and consider the vision. 70 weeks are determined upon your people. This is where it gets a little bit tricky, okay? But we're going to take our time. 70 weeks are determined upon your people and upon the holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy. Some translations say the most holy place. All right. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. That means 62. So right there, that's 7 plus 62 is a total of 69 weeks. What did he say at the beginning? There would be 70 weeks. So far we've gotten through 69 weeks, so that means that there's still 1 7-week period left. And he goes on to say, the street shall be built again, and the wall even in troublous times. And after 62 weeks, once again that's 62, shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself, and the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he, verse 27, now there's a big shift right here. When we get to it, we're going to really break it down. We probably won't even get to that tonight, all right? And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, and in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of the abominations, he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. All right, let's go back up real quick to verse 26. Verse 26, I just want to read that to you again because that's actually where the transition takes place. And after 62 weeks, hold on a second. Seven weeks up here, and then the 62 weeks. And it says right here, after that 69 week period, shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. That's talking about the cross right there. All right? That's a prediction that this is going to happen. Not a prediction, but a prophecy. A predicting prophecy. And the people of the prince that shall come. Now there's a whole transition that's taking place here. There's another prince it's speaking of now. The people of the prince that shall come, they're going to destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood unto the end of the war. Desolations are determined. Verse 27. And he shall confirm the covenant. What does he mean? Who is he? You know what an antecedent is? In English, it's a pronoun, and it just means that it has to be connected to the last subject that it was talking about. And so the last subject that it was talking about was this other prince. Who's this other prince? He's the prince of the people. And the people of the prince that shall come. He's a prince that's going to come. And these people are going to destroy the city and the sanctuary. And this same prince, this isn't still talking about Jesus, and I'm going to explain that to you. This same prince is going to confirm a covenant with Israel for 1 week, for that last 7 week period, that last 7 day period. And we're going to break that down in a second. And in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation, that means sacrifices, to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations. All right, so what I want to do now is that I've read that, and I want to go back to Revelation chapter 19. And this is what we did was we did a series for about three weeks or so about the Jewish wedding. Remember that? Those of you that have been here? And in the Jewish wedding, what we were determining was this. We were determining the similarities or the symbolism of the Jewish wedding to the overall salvation history of God. Amen? And what we talked about was the first part of the Jewish wedding was what was called the betrothal. It was like our modern day engagement, but it was altogether different because it required a contract. And the bridegroom would have to go to the bride's house, and he would have to offer marriage to her, and he would have to offer a purchase price. And so what we know is that Jesus became flesh. He came from the heavenly realm, amen, and he came to his bride's house, which is the earth. The scripture's full of God's people being his bride, amen, and that Jesus is the bridegroom. He came to his bride's house and he offered marriage to her, and he gave her a purchase price. And the purchase price was the shedding of his blood. Amen. He purchased his bride through the shedding of his blood. And then the bride would agree on that, and they would sign this document. This is a document that you got to be willing to agree to. Amen. This whole thing right here. It's called the covenant. It's the old and the new covenant. Amen. It's all one. It's in unity. And it's all telling the same story about Messiah that would come. And so, and in the meantime, so they have agreed on this. And then the bridegroom goes back to his father's house. I know I told y'all this many times as I was teaching it, but Jesus told Philip in John 14, "In my Father's house are many mansions. I'm going away to prepare a place for you, and I'm going to come back again. And if it wasn't so, then I wouldn't tell you." And so the bride would sit there and she would wait. And she didn't know exactly when he was going to show up. But when the bridegroom would come back, there would be the blowing of the shofar, which is like a trumpet, and there would be a wedding procession with him, and that's the parable of the wise and the unwise virgins. Five of them were ready, five of them weren't ready. The bridegroom's not waiting. When he shows up to knock on the door, it's time for everybody to go, amen? And the five unwise ones were ready, and they tried to go down to the store to get some oil for their lamp, and they missed the whole thing. They were already back at the Father's house. And so what we learned, though, was that during this time frame from the betrothal, that started for the modern day, what we call the church age. And so we're in this period of time right now. Does that make sense? The waiting period. We're waiting for our bridegroom to come back.
Yes.
We're hoping that we're like the five wise virgins. Amen?
Amen.
And we're waiting for him to knock on the door, for the trumpet to sound, and we're waiting for him to bring us back. Amen?
Amen.
But we're in the midst of that church age, and so we're engaged to him. It's a time frame of separation. We're not supposed to be living like the world. We're not supposed to look like the world. We're supposed to be different by the grace of God. You can't do it on your own strength. Amen?
Amen.
You need the grace of God moving and operating in your life. Jesus purchased grace for you at the cross. He wants to change you and empower you and strengthen you. And now we're in the midst of this time frame called the church age. But whenever the church age is finished, we see in Revelation chapter 19. Well, let's go ahead and just start reading to verse 1. "And after these things, I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Alleluia, salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments." Look at this. "For he has judged the great whore, which did corrupt the earth with her fornication, and has avenged the blood of his servants at her hand." Now, I can tell you right now, I've studied this enough, and I've taught it, and we'll teach it more. The great whore is false religion. And I can sit here and list off to you a plethora of things that perfectly fit this picture. And to be honest with you, I'm not going to go through the whole thing. But I'm here to tell you this. Everything that calls itself Jesus isn't Jesus.
Amen.
And the liar is an angel that transforms himself. I didn't write it. Paul did. He transforms himself into an angel of light. As a matter of fact, Paul warned, I think it's 2 Corinthians. Correct me if I'm wrong, Sean. 2 Corinthians or 1 Corinthians 11. "I'm concerned that just as the serpent deceived Eve, you too may be led astray from your simple and pure devotion to Christ Jesus. For if he comes preaching another Jesus..." Another Jesus, whom we didn't preach, And it's got another spirit whom you didn't receive. Now that's scary, church. And it's got a message with the name Jesus in it. And it's got a spirit connected to it. Did you know that Satan is a spirit? The Word of God says in Ephesians chapter 2 that there's a spirit that works in the children of disobedience. It's just as the Holy Spirit is moving mankind towards Jesus, the spirit of Antichrist is moving mankind away from Jesus and towards a cliff that's falling headlong into a devil's hell. And I'm here to tell you that the spirit doesn't always show up with a crack pipe, but instead that spirit will show up with eloquent words that sound just like, and he'll with smooth and enticing lips, he will speak even the name of Jesus, and it'll flow off his lips like honey, and it'll sound like it's the right thing, and I'm here to tell you, it's not the same gospel.
Yes.
You better be careful. And it's got a spirit connected to it. Come on. And it'll cause goosebumps to poke up on your arms. And if you're blind to it, you won't see it. And you'll be caught up in the mess. I've seen it before. I told you. I was in a seminar where they had hundreds of people. All the churches from this area were over there. And that man was preaching. And the Lord had gotten a hold of me. And he was opening my eyes. Man, you think whatever you want about this little fellow from Louisiana. But the Lord showed up and he at least opened my eyes. I'm far from perfect, but he at least let me see some things. And that man took that way. He was over there preaching about David. And he started doing all this stuff about a sling. And then he took some water and he threw it on the crowd. I thought it was at a Gallagher concert. And the crowd went crazy. Went into a frenzy. Ah! And all of a sudden, man, I looked. And I had the worst feeling in my spirit. I'm like, this is not the Holy Spirit. This is something altogether different. He was saying Jesus. He was saying Goliath and David. He was telling a story. But I'm telling you, there was another spirit behind what that man was doing. And the whole crowd was caught up in it. Come on, somebody. We got to be careful. Anyway, he judged the great war. She's false religion. And she's been in connection with the kings of the earth. The rulers of the earth. I'm telling you, they got some crazy stuff going on this earth. And there's a spirit of disobedience that's been in bed with the kings of the earth for thousands of years, and she's still in bed with the kings of the earth. And we're over here like a bunch of little puppets being moved around, but you need to get a hold of Jesus so that your eyes would be open, that you'd be faithful to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and you wouldn't be schnookered in the end, whatever that means.
Amen.
That's an old word that means deceived, hoodwinked, taken by surprise, ambushed when you're not looking.
Amen.
Amen. It goes on to say that he judged her, and again, verse 3, they said, Hallelujah, and her smoke rose up forever and ever, and 24 elders and the four beasts fell down and worshipped God that sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah, and a voice came out of the throne, saying, Praise our God, all ye his servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. You know, really, to get where I'm about to go with this marriage supper of the Lamb, we got to back up to chapter 18 to really get a good feel for what's going on. Look at chapter 18, verse 3. Now, let's start at verse 1. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen. Now, I'm here to tell you that I personally believe that Babylon is not just a physical location, but Mystery Babylon goes all the way back to the time frame of Nimrod and the Tower of Babel, and it goes back to the mystery religions, and it goes back to all of the lying spirits that have been disseminated upon the earth and have caused people to be hoodwinked by a spirit of deception. And I'm talking about it has to do with merchandise. I'm talking about it has to do with the music industry. I'm talking about it has to do with everything that we have see going on right now. It's all being played out, and it's all being managed by a spirit that's bigger than what you and I can see. And this is what's happening. But look what it says. Verse 3, for all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, talking about that mystery Babylon woman, that great whore. And the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. The Word of God saying that there's a spirit, that there's a false religion, that she is a, that she's mystery Babylon, she's connected herself to the kings of the earth, and that she has she's made the inhabitants of the earth drunk. I just was told I got 5 minutes left. I hadn't even started on Daniel. Lord, help me. Anyway, what I want you to see is this, verse 9, and the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and lived deliciously with her shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off. So what I wanted you to see was, all this is going on the earth. There's coming a day when judgment is coming on Mystery Babylon. False religion is going to be judged. False religion is going to be judged. The kings of the earth are going to be judged. The merchants, it said, bewail her. Why? Because they lost all their money in one day. It all went up in smoke. And while all that's going on earth, this is what's going on in heaven. Verse 7. Let us be glad. Verse 7 of chapter 19. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready, and to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. Hallelujah. Jesus purchased righteousness for you. Amen?
Amen.
And it says that the marriage supper of the Lamb. What I want you to know is, and I said all that because I wanted to make a point, that in the Jewish wedding, whenever the time frame of the waiting was over, the bridegroom would come, and actually the word in the Hebrew is elevate. He would elevate his bride and he would bring her home. Pick her up and bring her home. And what I want you to know is that from that time moving forward, at least in the Jewish wedding, there was a period of time of a feast that took place. At least in the physical Jewish wedding, there was a feast that took place. There's at least two spots in the Bible that talk about the fact that the feast would last 7 days. Alright? And there's other archaeological documents that say that. And so the two places that we're not going to turn to it, but it's in Genesis 29, whenever Jacob worked for Rachel. He found Rachel. He loved Rachel. I keep telling y'all about that story. She was beautiful. He loved her. He worked 7 years for her. And then he got hoodwinked because his father-in-law put Leah in the bed with him. And he woke up in the next morning and realized he was in bed with Leah and not Rachel. And he wasn't happy about it. And whenever Laban, his father-in-law, saw that, he said, hold on a second. Slow down. It's going to be okay. We'll make it right with you. Fulfill her week with her. And then we'll give you Rachel, but you still got to work 7 more years for both of them. Jacob was like, look, as long as you give me Rachel, everything's going to be all right. So he fulfilled the week, the 7 days for Leah, and then he was given, so there was a 7-day feast. Also in the book of Judges, Samson. The story goes that Samson went down to the Philistines. He saw a woman of Timnath over there. He wanted her for his wife. And anyway, I'm not going to get into all the details of the story. But, well, I got to make it make sense. He saw a lion on the way. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him, and he took that lion and says he ripped it like you would a goat. I don't know how you rip a goat that easy, but nevertheless, Samson ripped that lion like it was a goat and left it on the side of the road. And then he goes home and he tells his parents, I want that woman for my wife. And he went back down there to get her. The bridegroom going to get his bride, and he saw the carcass of that lion. Now, he had taken a Nazarite vow. He wasn't supposed to touch a dead animal. But he noticed in the carcass of that thing that there was a honeycomb. A bunch of bees had made a honeycomb. And he said, boy, that sure looks good. And he went over there because he really didn't care. And he grabbed a hold of that honey, and he started eating that honey, and he brought his future wife back with him. And he gives other people to eat of the honey. And then he decides to go make a riddle. And he says, I can't remember what the riddle was, something like, out of the eater came something sweet. And he wanted them to tell him what the riddle was. And so he said, you got 7 days as long as this banquet lasts, because it was his wedding banquet. And if you can come up with the answer. So the point I'm trying to make is that it seems as though in the ancient East, these wedding feasts lasted for 7 days. Now, we're going back to the concept of Daniel. And I'm trying to tell you that when we talk about a great tribulation, how many has heard before that people say that the great tribulation is going to last for 7 years? Have you ever heard that before? Raise your hand. I just want to get a show of hands. All right. So you've heard that before. Well, we're going to try to explain to you, and it's not going to be that easy, but we're going to try to come to the right conclusion on why people would think such a thing. First off, in my opinion, the Jewish wedding and that 7-day period, representative of a 7-year period, at the end makes really more sense than any one single scripture I can find. But we got somebody in the crowd that's going to be taking notes and is going to try to challenge us with questions. Amen? Nevertheless, let's go back to Daniel. All right? So we're in Daniel chapter 9. And it says right here, 70 weeks are determined upon your people. Now, first off, I just got to tell you something. You're just going to have to take my word for it. It says 70 weeks. So 70 and a week is what? 7 days? Is that correct? 70 times 7 equals 490. Now, so you can think that this is weeks, but in reality, I can tell you that it's not talking about weeks. It's a prophecy, and it's a hidden prophecy. And it's God, you know, the word of God says this in a proverb. It says that it's the, you know, the kings, I can't remember exactly how it goes, but it's the glory of kings to conceal a matter, but it's for men to try to search it out. Amen. And so God conceals what he desires to conceal. Amen. And it's our job as believers to try to search it out and to find the truth. And what I want you to know, though, is that whenever you look at this prophecy, and I just want to try to explain it to you on the front end as best I can, is that it's not talking about 490 weeks, but instead it's literally talking about 490 years, okay? And we're going to explain how we know that, all right? Here we go. We're going to start right here. It says right here, it's 70 weeks are determined upon your people. That's the first thing that I want you to see. It's very important that we stay true to the text, you know, because it's saying it's for your people. The 70 weeks is for your people. Whose people? Daniel's people. Who is Daniel? He's a Hebrew. He's a Hebrew boy that was brought captive. Amen? So he's a Jew. And so the prophecy is related to his people and upon your holy city. Amen? So what's the holy city? Jerusalem. And we know that Jerusalem was destroyed whenever they were taken captive to finish the transgressions. Now, I just want to go ahead and talk about this for a second. So in this 70-week period, which I'm really telling you is 490 years, and I'm going to explain some of that in a minute. In this 490-year period, these are some of the things that have to be accomplished. All right? Number one, to finish the transgressions. Some people have viewed that as though to put a complete end to sin. That's not really what it's talking about. If you review the chapters before this, the idea of the transgressions has to do with the Gentiles. All of these nations that I listed to you a while ago, Babylon, Persia, Greece, Rome, transgressing the holy city, transgressing Jerusalem, being on their land. Does that make sense? It's like a trespass, a transgression. So whenever this 490 years is up, one of the first things that needs to be finished is the transgression. The Gentiles need to be out of Jerusalem, and the people of Israel need to be free from that. Has that happened yet? No. I mean, I'm not trying to trick you. I'm just trying to ask you. I would tell you no, it hasn't happened completely. Why would I say that? Well, all you got to do is Google a picture right now. Go ahead, Google a picture of Jerusalem right now. If you got your phone, you can do it. I give you permission. What you're going to see is the Dome of the Rock. The Muslims have set up shop over there. The transgression's not over. The Gentiles and foreign land people are now squatting in the midst of Jerusalem. The transgression's not over. So that means that this prophecy can't be over. Amen? And so it goes on to say this, and to make an end of sins. Now, I thought this was interesting. So you would think on the front end, we're just going to take our time a little bit. I know I'm 5 minutes over, but we're not going to go get too concerned. To make an end of sins. You would think that at the end, and it is true, at the end, whenever it's all said and done, the millennial reign of Christ is going to happen. So if this number's right, if this last week, because remember what I told you all ago, there's 77s, and it's broken down into a little bit more than this, but there's a first 69 and then there's a last 7. What I'm trying to tell you is that this last 7, and we won't even get to it tonight, represents this time frame right here. Represents this time frame after, if we are believing in a pre-tribulation rapture and the church is gone at this point in time. I want to point something out in this passage though. That from the time frame, whether it's the rapture or really and truly the signing of this covenant, in my opinion, When that covenant is signed, or let's just say a pre-tribulation rapture, from that point moving forward is a seven-year period, and at the end of the 7 years, Jesus comes back. And so, while all this chaos is going down on earth, and the judgment of the great whore is taking place because she's committed fornication with the kings of the earth that we read in Revelation 18 and 19, all that's going on earth, that's called the Great Tribulation. Alright? And while that's going on earth, there's a marriage supper of the Lamb that's taking place up here in heaven. Amen?
Yeah.
Alright. And so, but what I wanted you to see is that to make an end of sin. So that word "end" there, when I researched that, the word literally means to seal up. So I started thinking about it. To seal up sin. And there's a lot of different commentators that have a lot of different opinions about it. And one commentator made the comment, and I'm going to be honest with you, I don't think that anybody can have the right answer, and I'm not scared to tell you that maybe I don't. But I can tell you that it's either only one of two things. And that the first thing that it could theoretically be is the fact that when Jesus, because this prophecy has to do with Jesus showing up, that when Jesus showed up and Messiah was cut off, you remember where it said that right there? It said right there in verse 25, from the going forth of to commandment to restore and build Jerusalem unto Messiah shall be 7 weeks. Then he goes on to say, Messiah shall be cut off in verse 26. That word "cut off" right there literally means to be killed, but not just killed. It means to be hacked up and to be separated like they did the animal sacrifices when they cut covenant. So as a sacrifice, Messiah will be cut off. It's talking about the cross. And so one interpretation could be that whenever Jesus died on the cross and you hear the gospel, I'm talking about you today, because this is true. Whether this is the right interpretation or not, I'm telling you the truth. Whenever Jesus died on the cross, paid the penalty for sin, went into the grave and resurrected from the grave because death had no right to hold him down, and you heard the gospel and you put your faith in that and you learned how to keep your faith in that, what happened was that it was almost like sin, in some sense, got sealed up, at least in your life. It doesn't mean that you're perfect. That's not what I'm trying to say. What I'm trying to say is that you can be given victory on this earth right now, today. It doesn't mean we're not going to make mistakes. Amen? That's what one commentator felt like it was. I don't really completely agree with that. I do agree that if you keep your faith in Jesus, amen, and what he did for you at the cross, that you receive grace and you receive strength, amen. And to some extent, it's as though sin has kind of been put in prison. That's what the idea is. I think the right interpretation of this scripture right here is talking about the millennial reign of Christ. In Revelation 20, we won't turn there, but it says in the book of Revelation that whenever the millennial reign happens, so what's going to happen is that, let's say we're talking about a pre-tribulation rapture right now. The rapture of the church takes place. Great tribulation is taking place on earth. The marriage supper of the Lamb up here for 7 years. And at the end of the 7 years, Jesus comes back for the battle of Armageddon. And then after that takes place, it ushers in what you call the millennial reign of Christ. A millennium is 1,000 years. Jesus comes and literally rules on the throne in Jerusalem upon this earth for 1,000 years as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen?
Amen.
And those that have served him, those that have lived for him, according to the parable of the talents, Matthew 25, I believe it is, those that did the right work while they were here in this vapor that they were given called life, didn't live for their flesh. Told somebody that also today. Can't go around living for our flesh, just whatever desires that we want to do and however we want to engage. No. You gotta, self must die. That's what the gospel does. The gospel causes the old man born of Adam to die. Amen? So that a new man can be resurrected to newness of life. You can't just, sometimes you want to, but by the grace of God, you need to ask the Lord to give you the strength that you need not to live in the flesh.
Amen.
But instead to live for the Spirit. Yeah. To believe, amen, that there's something bigger than what we see on this side. Amen? Yeah. Praise God. So to finish transgressions, to seal up sin. So listen, to put sin in prison. That's what the idea is. Whenever during the millennial reign of Christ, Satan, the great dragon, that's what it says, I believe it's Revelation 20. The great dragon is bound up and thrown into the bottomless pit for 1,000 years. He's released at the end of the 1,000 years, we won't get into why, for a short period of time to deceive the nations. For 1,000 years, sin will be sealed up, and during the millennial reign of Christ is the scripture that talks about in Isaiah about a wolf and a lamb lying together, about a child putting their hand on an adder, or another name for a serpent's hole, about lions eating straw, about men beating their weaponry into plowshares. In other words, they don't need weapons anymore. Amen. Mankind wasn't taught weaponry and the art of military tactics by God. Oh, Israel was maybe given the grace and the knowledge because they had to fight against a bunch of pagan devil worshipers. The truth of the matter is that war and the tactics of war weren't given to man by God. Anyway, that's another story for another time. They won't need it there. It's going to be peace. Because listen, right now, there's something restraining the power of sin. It's called the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is restraining the power of sin. And for believers, right now, you have Holy Spirit working in the midst of your life. Amen? But there's also a spirit of disobedience upon the earth. There's two kingdoms that are coexisting upon the earth. One's the kingdom of darkness, the other one's the kingdom of light. I've quoted Colossians 1:13 to you a million times, that whenever you place your faith in Christ, amen, you were translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of His dear Son.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
But there's going to be a day when there won't be a spirit of disobedience on the earth. Wow. You think you got victory now?
Oh,
wow. Amen. And that day, it's only going to be the Spirit of Christ ruling and reigning, amen, upon the earth.
Thank you, Lord.
So it's gonna seal up sins, and it's gonna make a reconciliation for iniquity. I thought that word was interesting about the reconciliation. That the word literally is Kippur, which is where we get Yom Kippur, which is the name for the Day of Atonement, which is where they put the blood on the mercy seat. I've gone too long. I'm going to lose y'all if I try to break all that down. To bring in everlasting righteousness. Jesus, the Prince of Peace, the righteous one. In the end, during the millennial reign of Christ, true righteousness, amen, will be here. Now, He's offering righteousness right now today for His people. For anybody that would give their life to Him. Amen? He's offering you the gift of righteousness so that you can have access to His grace. He goes on to say right here, and to seal up the vision and the prophecy. So when this prophecy is over, whenever these weeks are over, then this vision and this prophecy will be completely sealed up. That hasn't happened yet. And it goes on to say, and to anoint the most holy, and some translations say holy place. But the idea ultimately, and it could talk about Ezekiel's temple, there's a lot of different concepts that could be going on, but ultimately Jesus is going to come back and He's going to rule and reign upon the earth. Amen? And it's going to be the establishment of His millennial kingdom at that point in time. Now, right now, I do want to at least cover verse 25 and at least introduce you to it, and we're going to go ahead and we're going to start there again next week. It says, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. So what is that? Seven plus 62 equals 69. All right? 60. Remember when I told you that? A score is 20. So 3 times 20 is 60. Plus 2 is 62. Plus 7 is 69. I know it's kind of, but that's, I didn't, the Holy Spirit wrote it that way. 69 weeks. Which actually, if you do the math, comes out to 483 years. Because when you add 7 to that, the last 7, this 7 years over here, it equals the 409. Does that make sense? That's a pretty simple one. All right? So 483 years. So something's going to happen. There's a 483-year period right here. And the way that it's explained is that something has to happen first that starts the time clock for that to take place. The first thing that had to happen in order for this 483-year time clock to take place was there had to be a commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem. It had to go forth. Now, if you've been with us on Sunday mornings, we've been studying the book of Nehemiah. And in the book of Nehemiah, at the end, after this 70 years of captivity, and Daniel begins to pray, he's given this prophecy. It's about 100 years later that Nehemiah is the cupbearer to the king of Persia. Y'all remember that? I preached that first one about, what, 3 weeks to a month ago. And Nehemiah holds the cup for the king. And his job was the most important job in the palace. You know why? He had to sip the cup to make sure it wasn't poisoned. And so he was more trusted than anybody else in the palace. And he walked in there one day and his whole face was sad and downcast. You ever been sad and downcast and people that really know you know that something's not right with you? The king said, "What's wrong with you? I've never seen you like this before." He said, "Why shouldn't I be sad and downcast? The walls of my city are broken down." And from that point right there, Nehemiah gave a commandment to rebuild the walls. Not Nehemiah, the king gave a commandment for the walls of Jerusalem to be rebuilt. Scholars say...
Cyrus.
What's that?
Cyrus.
Yeah, thank you. Cyrus. Scholars say that that took place in 444 B.C. And what I'm telling you is that if you do the math, until... So what did it say? We're going to go over this again next week so that we're not going too fast. It says, from the time that the commandment to rebuild the walls takes place, that starts the prophetic clock, until Messiah the Prince. So from the time that the walls are supposed to be built until Messiah the Prince shows up, it's going to take this amount of time. And they say that whenever you go backwards and you do the math, and there's some different things that have to take place when you switch from the Hebrew calendar to the Gregorian calendar, that it literally comes out to 483 years to the T. Now the day that they calculate it to is to the triumphant entry, alright, on Palm Sunday. Now think about this, and I was going to turn to the scriptures and we will next week, but I just want to tell you this. Think about what Jesus did. You remember in John chapter 6, whenever he fed the multitude, what they did? It says that they wanted to take him as king. They wanted to take him by force and make him king. They realized that he was the son of David, the offspring of King David, and that he was the rightful heir to the throne. And whenever he started doing these miracles, they wanted freedom from Rome. They wanted to take him by force and make him king. And he wasn't, he stealed away. He went across the Sea of Galilee, really, to get away from them. He also told Pilate in the end, he said, "My kingdom is not from here. If my kingdom was from here, then my servants would fight." But yet at the same time, he also told Pilate, Pilate asked him, "Are you a king?" He said, "Did somebody else tell you that?" Jesus asked him that. He said, "I'm not one of your people. Why are you saying that?" He said, "Are you a king?" Jesus said, "For this cause I came, so that all might know the truth." But listen, on the triumphant day of Palm Sunday, this is what Jesus told his disciples. He said, "You're going to find a donkey." King James says an ass. "You're going to find a donkey and its colt. I need you to go get them." In Zechariah chapter 9, the word of God teaches, it says this. It was a prophecy. 600 years before Jesus showed up on the scene, Zechariah prophesied in Zechariah chapter 9, "Behold Jerusalem," I'm paraphrasing, "here comes your king, lowly and riding on a donkey." And 600 years later, Jesus, he knows what the Word of God says. He says, "Go get the donkey. You're going to go over here. You're going to find a donkey and you're going to find its colt. I need you to loose them and I need you to bring them to." He's waiting outside the city. He gets on top of the colt and they're pulling that donkey. I believe the donkey was probably in front. That's what I see. The donkey's empty. Jesus is riding on the colt. They show up towards Jerusalem and the people, I preached this about 3 months ago. Y'all remember that? Triumphal entry. The people show up and they start throwing palm leaves down on the ground. "Hosanna in the highest! Worship him! He's the son of David and he's worthy!" And all of a sudden the Pharisees get all riled up. Remember that? "Make your people stop! Tell them that they have to stop saying this!" Jesus said on that day, that was the one time Jesus didn't run from it. He didn't hide from it. He said, if they don't do it, the rocks are going to cry out. Because I am the King of Kings. He didn't say that, but I'm telling you what he was saying. I am the King of Kings. I am the Lord of Lords. This is a prophetic fulfillment that's taking place on this day. Daniel's prophecy, a time clock started whenever Cyrus told Nehemiah to rebuild the wall. Click, 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 click. It started. That didn't sound too much like a stopwatch, but that's what it was supposed to be. A timepiece started. A prophetic time clock started. And for 483 years, the next thing you know, on that day, triumphal entry, Palm Sunday, Jesus shows up. The 483 years is fulfilled. Amen? And what happens is that the donkey in the front is empty. That represents Israel. Israel didn't do what God wanted her to do. And so now she's barren. And it gets even better because the next day, Jesus, and you go read behind other scholars. I didn't come up with all this. The next day, whenever Jesus sees the fig tree, and it has leaves on it, but it doesn't have fruit, he curses it and it withers away. That represents Israel. She wasn't bearing fruit for God. On Fig Tree Monday, immediately, listen, the church isn't born for another 50 days. I'm sorry, the triumphal entry, a week later, the cross, the next day, the Feast of First Fruits Resurrection. It's 50 days from the Feast of First Fruits of Resurrection until Pentecost happens. And when Pentecost happens, the Holy Ghost falls on the disciples in the upper room. They get filled with the Holy Spirit. Peter preaches the first Holy Spirit-filled message. 3,000 people get saved, and the church comes into existence. And now from that time moving forward, we've been in the midst of the church age. But what I want you to know is that even for this little bitty period of time right here, God was already not using Israel anymore. Now, it's not that he's not going to ever use her again. Don't let anybody tell you that. He's waiting, and that's what this last 7 years is for. This last 7 years of the Great Tribulation is for your people, Daniel. 70 weeks are determined upon your people. The first 69 had to do from when the walls were built until Jesus showed up. The last seven are having to do with this time frame right here that Jeremiah called Jacob's trouble, the Great Tribulation. Because listen to me, I'm going to close with this. And I'm going to play at least one song, and if you need prayer, the altars are open. In your life as a Christian, when you found yourself, or even a non-believer, when you found yourself in the midst of circumstances where tribulation has hit your life, what did it make you want to do?
Pray.
Maybe you want to go, maybe you want to seek God, huh?
Yeah.
Seek the Lord.
Seek God, pray, cry out to Him. Mm-hmm. It never failed. I mean, as a young boy, there I was, all jacked up on all kind of stupid drugs and get myself locked up in a rehab after a rehab, get myself locked up in a detention home, and every time I'm there, somebody's coming to pass out Bibles. Every time I'm going somewhere, next thing you know, somebody's handing me a tract. Every time I find myself in the midst of a mess, the Lord shows up and He reveals Himself, and I can remember sitting there, Lord, won't You help me this time? Lord, won't You do a work in me this time? Can I tell you how many times I cried out to the Lord to do a work in me? But all it took was the right time.
Amen.
Don't ever think that God's going to give up on you. I'm telling you right now, He won't give up on you. I'll judge you. If I see something wrong with your life, if you leave it up to me, I'll judge you. Not because I want to, but because I'm a human being. And it's not right. But God is long-suffering and He's merciful and He won't give up on you. And just as God uses trial and tribulation in your life and in my life to bring us to a place where we're dependent and we want to look to Jesus, He's going to use the Great Tribulation in the time of frame of Israel. 70 weeks are appointed to your people to do these things. And in the midst of the Great Tribulation, the Word of God says in Zechariah chapter 12, and we'll say it again to remind you, that in those days, I'm going to pour out a spirit of grace and supplication upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And they will look upon me whom they pierced, and they will mourn for me as one who mourns for an only son. 600 years before Jesus ever showed up, the prophet Zechariah said that there was coming a day whenever the Jews would realize that they had crucified their promised Messiah, and they would look upon the one whom they pierced, and that they would mourn for Him, and that they would receive Him as their Lord and Savior. So just as God uses trial and tribulation in your life to turn your eyes to Him, He also will do that for His people Israel. Amen. He's not done with them.